Edutrainment Workshops, the insurance industry's leading education and training platform, presents Life Insurance, the entry-level series, the products, the underwriting, and the planning applications to position your practice as the premier provider of insurance products in your community. Get on board, get on track, get to where you're going. And now, your edutrainer, national insurance columnist, Steve Savant.
Well, welcome everyone. I'm Steve Savant, your edutrainer and your coach for our edutrainment workshops and our introduction into annuities. Perhaps you're new to the annuity business, you're coming from property casualty, maybe the securities, maybe even because of Obamacare, maybe you're looking at different revenue issues coming from the medical field. Whatever area you are, even banks are now heavily involved in annuities. We're going to give a very basic understanding over the next weeks and so forth with our workshops on the ideas of annuities. Now, if you missed any of our shows last week, I really recommend that you go out to the website, www.brokersalliance.com. As soon as you come to our website, you'll see this big red button, On Demand Videos. Go ahead and click it, and all of our edutainment videos are all there in its archives. And on top of that, of course, our daily internet broadcast, The Business Insurance Zone, and my weekend opinion piece, Welcome to the Weekend with Steve Savant. So let's get into it today. I wanted to first talk about today that what you can get. Anytime you see, you say, Steve, I saw that up on your screen. I really like that idea, the vocabulary list, the complete annuity vocabulary. We'll send it to you. Just request it at thebiz@brokersalliance.com, T-H-E-B-I-Z @brokersalliance.com. And I'll be happy to send it to you absolutely free. And any of the docs you see on it, you can request it. Hey, I like that one on deferred annuities or whatever you see up here. I'm happy to give it to you. And go ahead and order it again, thebiz@brokersalliance.com. Well, today I want to talk a little bit about some of the email I received from last week. And I want to touch on some things just because I just want to make sure we're all on the same page. Now, I want to go back to this issue called FIFO and LIFO. First in, first out, and last in, last out. Now, back in the day, and I've been around for a long time, so back in that day, in 1982, believe it or not, you could take your actual gain out of your policy, and you didn't have to take it out first. You could take your basis out first. It was great. Your basis came out first, absolutely tax-free. Then, of course, your gain came out later, and it was taxable. But in August of 1982, they decided to change the rules on this, and instead of doing FIFO, first in, first out, right, which means my basis was paid first, I get that first out, now it's last in, first out, LIFO. So whatever I do now, when my money comes out, with the exception of annuitization, and we'll get into that next week, really, when I put my money out, the gain comes out first, and of course, it's exposed to ordinary income tax, and possibly 59.5 issues, depends upon it's qualified, non-qualified, and other issues of the annuity as far as withdrawals and annuitizations. But basically, we move from FIFO to LIFO. Now, why do we even bring it up? There are sometimes obscure cases, and I've seen a few even still today, that where you find an old annuity that somebody didn't know they had. And when I see that date before around 82 or before, I'm going to look at it. Now, they're almost all gone. All those 1035 exchanges have already occurred. But sometimes if you can find a trail back to the original and the 1035, there are some carriers who look at that as a like contract. And that means that if you find a string of 1035s where there was no additional premium added to the contract, you could actually go back and you might be able to, depending upon how their legal department looks at it, might be able to treat that as FIFO. But for our general purposes going forward, we're going to be talking about last in, first out. Another thing as I wanted to bring up is there is still a no real, what I would call, uniform pattern for the free look policy. When you receive your policy, the client has 10 days, some states say 20 days, some specific states have gone to 30-day actual free look on a policy. So from the day that you hand the policy to the client and they sign the delivery statement, that clock starts on that day. So they could have, if they did, have buyer's remorse, they could turn the whole contract back in and that would be absolutely free. So even though they have an opportunity while the process of the application is taking place and there's an opportunity for them to kind of free look at this, they get an additional time now from the time that you do. And that's why it's very important to not only deliver the policy, but get a delivery policy statement signed that starts the clock and that's the date. If you don't turn your annuity into the client and you hold it in your office and you don't have delivery statements, you may be in violation of some state regs. So deliver the policy, get a copy of it for yourself, and get a delivery statement signed. Another thing that we're looking at here is free withdrawal periods. Now, even though we're trying to lock down a long period in time because an annuity is a long haul instrument, remember, you can actually take withdrawals out free. Certain contracts, most of the good contracts, are going to allow a 10% withdrawal feature. That 10% withdrawal feature is really good because sometimes you say, gee, I'm afraid of the illiquidity of an annuity, but it actually has some liquidity to it. Just heads up, if you do withdraw that money, of course, that's going to be exposed to a taxable event. And if you withdraw it before 59 and a half, it could be also subject to that penalty. So you just want to make sure you know what you're doing when you take your free look. But it has liquidity provisions, and some contracts, if you don't use it, they let you store it up for the next time. So if you didn't take a withdrawal that year, maybe you can get a little bit more the year after that. But if you're looking to make sure that you always have some position of liquidity, and if 10% fits your budget, that's what you should look at when you're looking at the issue of the free look period and the free withdrawal period. It's an excellent, excellent tool when you're talking to the client. I try to tell them right up front, you do have access to this, so that they don't feel like that 6 years later they can't even touch this unless they had an emergency. Now, another thing too, I want to talk about immediate annuities, because today and all this week we're going to be talking mostly about the accumulation periods and about deferral. But immediate annuities came on, I mentioned it last week, and people are saying, wow, is it really worth looking at a single premium immediate annuities right now? And my answer to that is, not by the rate. The rates are so suppressed and the interest rate environment is so low that no, that really doesn't look like it's a really good thing to look at. However, that being said, as the client gets older, I've noticed demarcation lines, male 70, maybe female 75, where SPIAs, because of their mortality credits that they have on these contracts, that sometimes those can be really good and perform well. Just remember, heads up, once I executed the single premium annuity, I really lost my ability to stop the payment and go back in and get principal out of it. Now, there are contracts that allow this. I'm just giving you the generic understanding of single premium annuity. Once I turn on that income, it's on and I can't get back to my principal. But several carriers have felt the pain of consumers who felt like they didn't have liquidity, or the person would buy a single premium annuity and then die the next day and they would have nothing to show for it for their beneficiaries. So there are many contracts now that use refunding and so forth to make sure that the illiquidity or the ability to at least get back what you had into it with interest, that's there, and those contracts are out there, and I just recommend it. But I really don't recommend it until we get to the older ages, because the environment right now and the interest rate environment is just so low. So I want to encourage all of us to look at the age group. The higher I get up into the 70s, the more I'm going to look at it and say, is there a difference between even an SPIA income scenario versus maybe an indexed with an income rider scenario? I need to look at them both because I'm not really sure which one's going to win. I'll generate an in-force ledger, try to see which one's going to be able to give the client the most income with the most perks. Another thing I want to talk about is, to my knowledge, this issue of insolvency. To my knowledge, even though we've had many carriers go down, I'm not aware of every one annuity carrier that might have lost their position, so much so that they weren't able to pay the guarantees in the contract. Now, I don't know if that's true or not across the board. You could never use a statement like that in a sales. I'm just talking about the history of our industry. We've been pretty good about absorbing the problem children by having another carrier swoop in, buy the contracts out, and try to make at least the clients hold to the guarantees. Again, remember, I don't know for a fact that it's that way, but you can never use the historicity of a non-insolvency for all the carriers that we deal with, even if it's true, because that's not really a statement that I can bring forward into the future. You never know when a company will have problems. Another thing is this interest rate bonus. Now, I want you to be careful about this, because this is where we see suitability issues. We didn't fully disclose or caveat to the client. Some bonuses are only good after you hold it. They're not automatically inserted. So if a company's saying, I'm paying a 10% bonus, and that bonus is predicated on you holding it for all 10 years, then you have to hold it for all 10 years. They may even say, if you execute withdrawals, that bonus may be reduced, or you may have negated it. You may have to annuitize the annuity to get the bonus. So always remember, the bonuses are great attractions to look at a contract, but look at the contract and how can I use this bonus, and is it really a good deal, especially if I have to annuitize? I want to see what that number is. Another thing that I'm looking at right now is this issue of joint annuitants. Should we have separate annuities or joint annuities? depending upon the goal of the client. Remember, that's always the thing that we're looking for. We want the client to have a great ownership experience. So our job is to generate the most income and try to do that over the longest period in time that we can and have a tax advantage to it. And it's possible to do that. But should I do a single annuity or should I do a joint annuity? Should I have a single owner? Should I have a joint owner? Those things are all dependent on what am I trying to get done during the income stream or the annuitization of the policy later on. Because remember, I don't want to accumulate annuities just to accumulate money. Ultimately, I want to use this for some form of income, generally in retirement. So I want to be able to always make sure I need to make that selection or that declaration up front, but I need to know what the client's thinking. What do they want to get done? What can I suggest that maybe they haven't considered yet? So when I look at that, I'm looking at, should I do joint annuitant and joint ownership, or should I separate them and make them separate? Now, another issue I wanted to talk about is the maturity date. Now, these contracts all have special durations to them, and I want to make sure that you look at what those maturity dates are, the windows to annuitization, and all the perks in the policy that you can do during the life of that annuity. I want you to make sure that you know that date and understand, is there a window where I have to move it to another contract or reestablish that contract, or does it automatically go in to another period, and do I want to do that? And remember, that's a really big mistake. If I don't understand that and I come to that window where I go to my client, I said, oh, I missed the time and the window that I could have moved this to another annuity that's paying maybe more. So you just want to be up to speed on the maturity or the endowment of some of these contracts. Another thing I saw in my email from you is non-qualified annuities versus qualified annuities. Now, just for a second, qualified annuities are under ERISA, and those are generally going to be tax deductible, and you can put annuities in those contracts. But when you take distribution out of a qualified plan, then you lose your ability to use basis tax-free. So all the distributions that come out, and it still may be a good thing, maybe a good deal, but if you're using qualified plans and you want to use an annuity for one part of your portfolio to be guaranteed or a lockdown rate, you may want to look at this and say, okay, I know that I'm getting the deduction, but later on, I'm going to have to face the music here and I'm going to have to pay the full taxable event on my basis and my gain. So just heads up, it can be good and it could be used wisely in a qualified plan. Now, in non-qualified, I still have exposure to my basis. And what I like about that is depending upon how I generate annuitization, for life option only, I could be able to capture some of my basis up front as it's amortized across the life expectancy of the client. Now, we talked about this last week, so again, if you're just coming in today, go back to last week, I actually addressed this. One of the reasons why I'm touching some of these things are these are the more popular questions I was getting, and I'm really surprised because 1 week into it, we're already getting some of these ideas. I also want to talk about the specimen contract. If you like about 4 to 5 carriers, let's say you do, and let's say you see their inventory of those 4 or 5 policies, and you think that's going to be your main core contracts, you should all order specimen contracts. Every carrier will give you a specimen contract so that you can read it, become acquainted with it, understand the policy provisions, and understand the exact language and try to get somebody at the carrier level to explain it, or your IMO, us, i.e. us. We can explain some of these basic concepts, but we really like the carriers. If we find something that's a little bit too legalese, we want them to explain it to us. So my encouragement to you here is you have 4 or 5 contracts, go out to each carrier and say, hey, I need a sample contract. I always want to have it in my office. I always want to have that in my briefcase. I want to be able to have it on my computer if they'll allow it. I love all that because I can point to certain provisions and certain policy perks that actually could be really good for closing. And my last thing, and I really want to talk about this, surrender charges. Every contract generally has a surrender charge. You have to be absolutely aware of not only the charge, but how long will the charge go out? Make sure that you understand what this means if your client surrenders it. This could be very hurtful to the client. You have to be able to explain surrender charges and the percentage to keep your due diligence above board and keep your client completely caveated.
This has been an Edutrainment Workshop, the educational division of the National Insurance Clearinghouse, the marketing arm of Brokers Alliance.